So Intel just launched their brand new codename Broadwell EP-based Xeons. I mean, these things are bananas. The top of the line one has 22 cores, 45 megs of cache, a quad channel DDR4 memory controller, and best of all, did I mention that we've already got one? No, I didn't, because that would be a lie. We have two. Tunnel Bear is the easy-to-use VPN service that lets you use the web as though you're in one of 20 different countries. Learn more and try Tunnel Bear for free at the link in the video description. Now, as impressive as the E5-2699V4 might be under the hood, CPUs are never really much to look at physically, but that won't stop us from investigating some of the differences between this and the older Haswell-based V3 processors. So first of all, they've redesigned the heat spreader. I don't know exactly what the engineering reason for these little flanges that come out into the corners are, but if I had to guess, I would say it would be to transfer the contact pressure of the CPU heatsink onto the pads and the pins in the socket below more evenly. And then the other thing that they've changed is it no longer overhangs the socket, and it's actually closer to the size of a desktop chip than the previous Xeons were, with these like ultra super mega wide heat spreaders on them. Now there are some similarities here, and this will be good news for high-end desktop enthusiast users or workstation users who are not necessarily going to drop, I think this one's like $4,500 US on a 22 core model, but might be interested in a high core count model. And that is that it uses the same 2011 contact pads on the bottom and is therefore socket compatible with LGA 2011-3, meaning that as long as your motherboard maker provides a BIOS update, this will be a drop-in replacement for the older V3s and even desktop processors, assuming you've got a board that will support it. So naturally then, the first thing I'm gonna do is throw it on my gaming desktop test bench and see how it goes. But before we do that, I want to get some oh, did I just die? That was quick. Anyway, before we do that, I want to get some baseline numbers on a 5960X Extreme Edition desktop processor so we have something to compare this brand new top of the line 22 core against. Benchmark-wise, I'll be doing a very, very limited set, so we'll be running Crysis 3 to represent gaming. We'll be running Cinebench as well as W-Prime. So with our baseline numbers run, all that's left to do is find out if our motherboard has a BIOS update. We can't tell because ASUS, and for everyone for that matters, BIOS update release notes are notoriously terrible. So all we can do now is update to the latest one, tear the system apart, and give it a shot. All right, moment of truth. Yeah, this is not looking like it is going to work. We're getting a postcode 53, maybe it will change. And no, but that's okay, because this is just a minor setback. Broadwell E, the enthusiast desktop equivalent for Broadwell EP, is not set to land for however long. I actually have no idea. So it makes sense, I guess, that some of the more desktop-oriented boards would not have Broadwell EP support, but that's okay, because we have a system that definitely does. This is 8 gamers, 1 CPU, the Michael Bay-style sequel to 7 gamers, 1 CPU. It's bigger, it's badder, it's better. And it's also deceptively named because in addition to actually running 2 CPUs, because come on, quite frankly, if you've got a workload that can benefit from 22 cores and 44 threads, did I mention that CPU has hyper-threading? Then you've probably got a workload that can benefit from 44 cores and 88 threads. So we're gonna be using this bad boy to deceptively put 2 CPUs in and also deceptively run up to 10 gaming VMs. But it's gonna be a little bit different because this chassis supports, and you'll see here, hopefully, there we go, supports 8 video cards in its sort of advertised configuration, but thanks to its 11 PCIe 16X slots, onboard 10 gigabit networking, dual 10 gigabit networking, I am planning to put an additional 2 cards in here to hopefully get 10 gaming VMs running and streaming using Steam in-home streaming to 10 different clients all over the building instead of having everyone tethered to the system this time. So all we've got to do then is apply the latest BIOS update and throw the CPUs in here for our testing. But before we put the 22 cores in that machine, I actually had to pull out the 8 Zotac GTX 980 Ti amps and replace them with just one Titan X so I could get an apples to apples comparison against my top of the line desktop 5960X. The cool thing here is that this is 2 18 cores, the previous flagship. Before that, the flagship E5 was a 12 core. We actually have one of those in Ed's machine. Maybe let me know in the comments if you'd like to see a generation by generation comparison there. And so we've gone from 12 to 18 to now 22 cores, but, and this is really interesting, the 2699 V4 that we have actually has 24 physical cores on it, meaning that if they were to create an additional 24 core SKU when yields improve or whatever, they potentially could, which is pretty cool. So we ran through the same benchmarks, Chrysler 3 Cinebench and W Prime, but it should be noted at this time that W Prime, no matter how many threads I set it to, isn't really scaling, so I might just leave that out. So with that out of the way then, all right, let's put some 22 core CPUs in here. Let's lock and load. Here we go. 44, oh. Dang it. Doesn't matter how experienced I get at this stuff. I still forget to plug in the power supply sometimes. Okay. Try that again. Lock and load. 44 cores. Hilariously, that's not nearly as loud as it was when we had the default fans in here. I actually posted a Periscope stream of me turning it on for the first time. It was deafening. Please turn on. Oh, hello. Hey, wow, that was the longest post I've ever seen in my life. Whew. Okay then, let's get into the BIOS here. What the hell was that? It's like they want me to have a freaking heart attack. 44 core machine not turning on. Jeez, why is it that my stress is your entertainment? Hey, where's my BIOS screen? Okay, so that's it. Video card is still detected. All good in the hood. Wow. That, my friends, is what 44 cores, 88 threads. Looks like. Just like that. Stock speed of this puppy, actually not much higher than the previous one. In fact, I think it's a touch lower, but you do get architectural improvements from going from Haswell to Broadwell for the microarchitecture of the CPU itself. And let's see what that translates to. So we'll fire up, let's do Cinebench as our first run here. Because I guarantee you, almost none, if any of you have ever seen a Cinebench run that looks like this. And done. Over 5,000 points, 5214. Unfreaking real. I certainly have never seen anything like it. Let's run it again, just because, hey, it doesn't take very long, right? So CPU usage, 100% across 44 cores, 88 threads. Yeah, whatever. No big deal. But can it run Crysis? Only one way to find out. Okay, so while I haven't run the benchmark yet, I think I can say with a fair degree of certainty that yes, yes it can, because all tabbing out reveals that Crysis 3 is utilizing 5.6% of this CPU. 6.4 is what we peaked at there. Whoa, how is that even possible? Okay, it's actually using a reasonable amount of it. You can see most of it's on this one random core right here, but there are some other cores. Oh, and it fell back down again. All right, so let's do this. Let's run the bench. Can it run Crysis? Ba-ba-ba! I don't know what Crysis 3's music sounds like. Die, you can die too, you can die too. Ah, let's jump over this thing. I kind of screwed up my jump there, that's okay. Boom! So all that's left now is a bit of a wrap-up. Yes, it can play Crysis, it's a silly question. Of course it can. It's got about the power of multiples of our highest-end desktop processor in it, but it's only really truly utilized in more multi-threaded workloads, like, for example, Cinebench that is high-end 3D rendering, or in a heavily virtualized environment like what I have planned for it. In terms of power consumption and temperatures, once again, I'm impressed. In spite of the 22 cores under the hood, our total system power consumption at idle is around 200 watts. Remember, that includes those beefy fans over there. And our load power consumption is around 500 watts with IDA 64 running full tilt in the background. Let's go ahead and pull that up. And our load temperatures, even with these goofy coolers, I mean, they're good coolers, but they're not amazing, is under 50 degrees. It does help to be able to spread out the cores when you've got lots and lots of cores. You have a larger heat source, so it's a little bit easier for the heat to transfer. So I think that pretty much wraps it up. What was the point of this video? Well, point number one is, holy shit, that's cool. Point number two is that while this is not something you're gonna be running in your desktop, you know, now, the thing to note about these kinds of technology showcases is that all this stuff eventually does trickle down. I mean, remember 12 core, like 2.5 years ago, was the top of the line for servers. And now the rumor is that Broadwell E, the desktop version of this, is gonna have a 10 core Extreme Edition. So there you go. It's a sight of what's to come, if nothing else. Ting is an unusual mobile carrier, one that's focused on customer service and customer satisfaction first. When you call them, I'm about to blow your mind. You do not speak to a robot. It was pretty disconcerting the first time I did it. I called and someone was like, hello. And I was like, what wizardry is this? You actually get put through directly to a person who asks you what you want and takes care of you. And you don't actually have to pay a whack ton of extra monthly fees for that service. In fact, the average Ting bill is only $24 per month per device. Well, hold on a second, Linus, why would it be like an average bill? Why wouldn't they just have like contract rates? Because that's not the way Ting works. It's all about using what you use and paying for exactly what you use. So in order to find out if Ting would be better for you, all you gotta do is head over to linus.ting.com, linked in the video description, and try out their savings calculator. You enter your last three bills and how much you paid for them, and then your actual usage, and boom, Ting shows you how much you would be saving. If you're stuck in a contract and you switch to Ting, they'll cover 25% of your cancellation fee up to $75. And if you sign up using our link, you'll also get $25 in service credit or towards a new device. So thanks for watching, guys. If you disliked this video, hit the dislike button. But if you liked it, hit the like button, get subscribed, maybe consider getting a cool shirt like this one, using our Amazon affiliate code to shop at Amazon if you happen to be doing that anyway. We've got instructions up here. Or even contributing directly through our community forum by answering people's questions, asking your own questions, or even becoming a contributor member where you get a little cool badge and all that stuff. Now that you're done doing all that, you're probably wondering, what should I watch next? Well, maybe you should check out our channel Superfund video, which we've got a link to up here. We've got a lot of stuff that we've done recently that's awesome, and a lot of stuff coming down the pipe for that channel. So don't miss any of it by getting subscribed over there.